Is there anyone here this morning? Thank you, Dawn, for that one good morning. Merry Christmas week to you. Can you believe it? It's Christmas week, and it hasn't felt like Christmas. It hasn't felt like December until the last couple of days. But it's here, and we have a lot of stuff going on this week. The youth are meeting tonight at 6 o'clock. They're going to be running through their play a couple of times. And also, Wednesday night, they're having dress rehearsal at 6 p.m. Also, if you would like to be added or removed from the nursery list, see Wendy. If you'd like to be added or removed from the prayer wheel, see my wife. If you'd like to be added to the church directory, also see my wife. So there's those lists you can be added on to for next year. Also, there'll be a Christmas Eve candlelight service here on Thursday at 7 p.m., so you'll want to come out for that. Also, a New Year's Eve party at the Community Center starting at 7 p.m., and youth Christmas party has been moved to January 3rd at 6 o'clock, and all the youth are to bring a snack and a gift that's under $10, and they're usually wonderfully brilliant gifts that are for the white elephant or dirty Santa, whatever you call that game. They have a lot of fun with it. So that'll be January 3rd. And also, we need a couple of men to stay just after the service for a minute or two to help move some furniture around for the play on Christmas Eve. Does anyone else have any other announcements? All right, let's open with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this glorious day. Lord, we're so happy to be able to come into your house and to come before you and to worship you. And so, Lord, now we just pray that in this time that you would settle our hearts, that we would set our thoughts on you, and Father God, that we would seek nothing else but you and your Holy Spirit. We thank you and we praise you, and it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes because there was no room for them in the inn. Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in the manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men."
Stand and join us in some worship, some Christmas worship.
We were
And the Troutman family is going to come and give our Advent greeting.
Today we'll be reading Matthew 2, 1 through 2, and 9 through 11. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judah, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born the King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and of incense and of myrrh. Today will be lighting candles 1, 2, 3, and 4. The Magi traveled from afar to see not just an earthly king. The Magi traveled to worship the heavenly king. This morning we light the fourth candle, the candle of Christ the King. Jesus' kingdom is not of this world. This is the truth that Magi recognized. Upon their visit to the child Jesus, they knew the truth that though an infant, now we view him, he will share his father's throne. Jesus may have come as a child. He may have hidden his power in flesh, but that was not only for a time. For in the future, the time will come where every knee shall then bow and worship Christ the Lord. All people of all time will recognize him for who he is, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Bow your head for prayer. You are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We proclaim, like the angels, the shepherds, and the magi, that you are the King of our lives. To you be all the glory, all the praise, and all our worship. Amen.
At this time, I'd like to ask the ushers to come forward for the morning tithes and offerings.
Lord God, thank you for today. Thank you for all that you do for us. Ask that you bless this offering through your use. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Rolled along. peace on earth, goodwill to men. Then from each planet, a cursed mouth, cannon thunder in the south, and with a sound, the carols round.
Thank you.
we sing for you. And all we do it for you. Thank you for Jesus Christ. And it's in his name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. May we sing. Come to our time of prayer and praise requests. Does anyone have a praises and prayer request? Does anyone have a praise that they'd like to share? What's God been doing good this week? Yes, Sarah.
I finished the semester and all the prayers that you guys gave me, it was definitely a lot harder than even my other semesters previously
done.
But I finished with
getting a scholarship. Okay. Yes, Dawn. Okay.
And thank you, everybody, for all the prayers through the last few years.
Okay. So, another hand. Yes, Pam.
I want to praise my church family. They've got me through some hard times, and it's also my family. Something.
Okay. Mark, okay.
My sister made it to rehab. She's doing really good rehab on herself, so a shower.
Okay. Yes. Okay. They sent a letter to the Steelers. Yes, Larry.
James is glad he can see you clearly today.
Okay. Yes, Heather.
My cousin Nathan came through his heart surgery monthly. It was 4.5 hours, and he has a long road to go, but it went very well.
Okay. Yes, Ed.
Ben, I'm safe.
Okay. Yes, Jim.
My sister's husband is on the rehab. He broke
him. Okay. Yes, Sean.
Just thankful for all your prayers. I get my brace off tomorrow, so just hope for PT and, you know, a quick recovery. So,
okay.
Very much appreciate it.
Yes, Jim.
For a real time, I'm glad
you did. Okay. Yes, Al.
Tiffany's home. Maybe she's embracing jet lag.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Kim's grandmother had successful surgery. How about prayer requests? Had a couple that come in. Remember Flo to Pearl this morning? She'd been having trouble with her feet swelling up. So they're asking for prayers, and Janet said she was too stubborn to go to the doctor because she didn't want to be sent to the hospital because Christmas Eve is always at their house. But to remember her this morning, that she gets some relief from that. Also for Ezra Williams this morning, remember, do you have an update for us? Okay.
Has skin problems because of all the old and
the past and the way his jewelry comes out and the way his files work. And it's just a seems like there's no solution of what to do for his life. So we're asking prayer for wisdom, for Shady and Tim and the doctors to make a decision that will work for him.
Okay. Also remember Ken Weaver, he's in Sligo, not doing well, and Heidi Bish, which would be my aunt. She has got some bad news about her cancer returning, has to have some surgery coming up. Is there any other prayer requests this morning? Is there any others? Yes.
Dustin
Truck.
Truck.
Truck. Any other? Yes, Eileen.
I'll say travels for all of our kids coming in this week. Anyone
travel? Is there any others? Yes, Lori.
I also say travels for Jerry's oldest grandson. He's coming in from Wisconsin to spend Christmas with us.
Okay. Anyone else? At this time, if you'd like to come forward for Heidi, Dawn, say, would you like to come forward for Ezra this morning? Janet, would you like to come forward for Flota this morning? And would someone like to come forward for Ken Weaver? Just anoint them for sit in this place. Fern's going to come up for, and anyone else that would like to come up to be anointed or sit in for anyone else, we can do that at this time. Let's enter into a time of prayer. Heard all of the praises. We know that you are active and you are working on behalf of us for our good on a daily basis. And Lord, that we know that you are powerful enough to take each situation and to place in your control. Father, we come to you on behalf of Heidi Bish as she goes to have this procedure. They think that the cancer has returned, Father, and the family is looking for hope and looking for what to do and where to turn to. Father God, we pray that you would show them that you are their hope. And it's only through you that she can find healing. And so, Lord, we lift Heidi up to you, trusting in your healing hand. Lord, we think of Ezra this morning. Father God, how many battles has this little one had to go through? To this point, he's won every one. Lord, thanks to your strength and thanks to your care. And Lord, we lift him up as he has another one with this broken leg. And Lord, the doctors are unsure what to do. And Tim and Shaney are unsure where to what to do with him. And Lord, we pray that you would give them a clear direction. And Lord, we pray for a mighty miracle. Lord, that it would take care of itself even, that you begin to heal up those bones now. Lord, that no surgery would even be needed. Father, we pray for a mighty move. A mighty move of power, Lord. Father, we come to you on behalf of Ken Weaver and Lord, having so much trouble with his legs and his feet and Lord, just not having any hope there as he's in Clearview. And Father God, we just I pray that you would begin to give relief, Lord, that you begin to open back up circulation, Father, where it's needed. And Lord, that you would just be the healer that you have told us that you are. Lord, by your stripes we are healed. We claim that this morning. And Lord, we just we pray that your stripes will begin to heal Ken in this hour. Father God, we also think of Floda this morning. And Lord, with all these issues with her feet and them swelling up as soon as she stands or moves around a bit, Lord, we pray that we know that her heart's desire is just to be able to have all the family gathered around on Christmas Eve. And Lord, we pray that you would cause this to be so. Lord, that you would take this affliction away, this problem that's occurring in the feet, Lord. Lord, we pray that you cast it as far as the east is from the west. And Lord, this holiday season, this Christmas season, she can spend glorifying you and praising you with all of her family and gathered around her. Father God, all of the other requests that were mentioned, Lord, we lift those up to you at this time. And Father, we pray that you would move among us and work as only you can work in your power and in your time. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Only the children that are involved in the Christmas Eve play are going to children's church today. So if you are in the kids' play or want to be in the kids' play, go down at this time with Kim. I was a weird kid, but when I was in junior high school, I started, and I can remember it was a little gray notebook, and it was about this big, and I as soon as I found a quote that I liked, I would write it in this book, and so I began, I called it my quote books, and every time I came across something that was interesting, or something that I found that, you know, tickled a funny bone, or you know, anything that was impactful or entertaining, I would write it in. And throughout the years, all through college, and now they have the internet, so I don't really have to do it anymore because, you know, everything's kept there for you. But all through college, when I'd come across anything interesting that a professor would say, I'd write it down in one of these books. And I was going through one of these books as I was cleaning out a desk drawer, and I found one and was going, and I turned to a page, and at the top of the page it says, Optimist versus Pessimist. And so here are the quotes from that page. We can complain because rose bushes have thorns, or rejoice because thorn bushes have roses. That was Abraham Lincoln. Oscar Wilde once said, the optimist sees the donut, the pessimist sees the hole. And that was fitting because we had donuts for Sunday school this morning. Or how about this one? Some see the glass half full, others see it half empty. I see a glass that's twice as big as it needs to be. That was George Carlin. And then Winston Churchill famously said, a pessimist sees the difficulty in every opportunity. An optimist sees the opportunity in every difficulty. So how many glass half full kind of people do we have here this morning? Three of you. Congratulations. How many pessimistic people do we have here this morning? Okay, a few of you. We're always looking to the bad, but and which one is right? Which one's a better view of the world? No one wants to say, because sometimes we have days where we're optimistic, some days we're pessimistic, but I like to look back into the old Noah's Webster's dictionary. And in 1828, I have an old dictionary, the word optimism means this. It's the opinion or doctrine that everything in nature is ordered for the best, or the order of things in the universe that is adapted to produce the most good. So the optimist is saying, oh, there's so much good in the world, we need to point to the good, and God's at work doing good things. So I took that old dictionary and I looked up the term pessimism. And do you know what it means? Well, in 1828, the word pessimism did not exist. The word pessimistic did not exist. And so I did some research on it. I was like, why? What? This has to be in our English language. Where is it? But it seems that the view of pessimism is a modern invention. As far back as 1828, it did not exist. It was only optimism and nothing else. Now, if you think back to the Christmas story this morning, it's all on everyone's mind. It would be very easy, and we oftentimes think of it very optimistically and think of all the good that's come out of it, but put yourself in the shoes of Mary and Joseph just for a second. Would it be very easy for Mary and Joseph to develop a pessimistic view of the Christmas story? Think of all that they had to do. First, you're forced to leave your home with a pregnant wife to travel 75 miles by donkey. Now, the Bible doesn't say this, but I assume that they had to stop every 20 minutes for Mary to stop and pee. Because if you've traveled with pregnant women, that's about how fast you go. So then you get to Bethlehem, and you're tired from the journey, and the journey's taken about 3 or 4 times longer than it probably should have. And you know, that irritates men sometimes. How many? Amen? Yeah, that irritates men. And so you're looking around for a place to stay, and you go to this place and that place and this place, and no one has any places to stay. See, if we didn't stop so many times to pee, we'd have had a place to stay tonight. So you have to give birth to your firstborn child in a barn. And then to make matters worse, you have to escape town before Herod finds out where the baby is and where you are because he wants to kill you. Now, is there plenty of reasons to be pessimistic about this story? Absolutely. Yes, there is. But remember, pessimism did not exist at this time. Because people always looked at the big picture. They always had the faith to look to God and say, okay, God, I know things that look terrible, I know things look bad, but you've got a big picture and a big plan, and so we're going to trust in you. As we are finishing up our story, or our series on the book of Acts, we come to a time where Paul has plenty of reason to be pessimistic about what he finds himself into. And let me tell you, up until this point, he's been wrongly imprisoned, he's been beaten, he's been persecuted, but Paul is about to have the bad days of all bad days. We think that we have bad days. Paul puts a new meaning to the word bad day. So let's turn to Acts chapter 27, and we're going to start in verse 27 and read through chapter 28, verse 10, to see how Paul handles the situation when bad things are thrown at him. It's Acts 27, 27. It says, on the 14th night, we were still being driven across the Adriatic Sea when about midnight the sailors sensed they were approaching land. They took soundings and found that the water was 120 feet deep. A short time later they took soundings again and found it was 90 feet deep. And fearing that they would be dashed against the rocks, they dropped 4 anchors from the stern and prayed for daylight. In an attempt to escape from the ship, the sailors let the lifeboat down into the sea, pretending they were going to lower some anchors from the bow. Then Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, unless these men stay with the ship, you cannot be saved. So the soldiers cut the ropes and held the lifeboat and let it drift away. Just before dawn, Paul urged them all to eat. For the last 14 days, he said, you have been in constant suspense and have gone without food. You haven't eaten anything. Now I urge you to take some food. You need it to survive. Not one of you will lose a single hair from his head. After he said this, he took some bread and gave thanks to God in front of them all. Then he broke it and began to eat. They were all encouraged, and eat some food themselves. Altogether, there were 276 of us on board. When they had eaten as much as they wanted, they lightened the ship by throwing the grain into the sea. And when daylight came, they did not recognize the land, but they saw a bay with a sandy beach where they decided to run the ship aground if they could. Cutting loose the anchors, they left them in the sea and at the same time untied the ropes that held the rudders. Then they hoisted the foresail to the wind and made for the beach. But the ship struck a sandbar and ran aground. The bow stuck fast and would not move, and the stern was broken to pieces by the pounding of the surf. The soldiers planned to kill the prisoners to prevent any of them from swimming away and escaping. But the centurion wanted to spare Paul's life and kept them from carrying out their plan. He ordered those who could swim to jump overboard first and get to land. The rest were to get there on planks or in other pieces of the ship, and that way everyone reached land safely. Once safely on shore, we found out that the island was called Malta. The islanders showed us unusual kindness. They built a fire and welcomed us all because it was raining and cold. Paul gathered a pile of brushwood, and as he put it on the fire, a viper, driven out by the heat, fastens itself on his hand. When the islanders saw the snake hanging from his hand, they said to each other, "This man must be a murderer, for though he escaped the sea, the goddess Justice has not allowed him to live." But Paul shook the snake off into the fire and suffered no ill effects. The people expected him to swell up or suddenly fall dead, but after waiting a long time and seeing nothing unusual happening to him, they changed their minds and said he was a god. There was an estate nearby that belonged to Publius, the chief official of the island. He welcomed us into his home and showed us generous hospitality for 3 days. His father was sick in bed, suffering from fever and dysentery. Paul went in to see him, and after prayer, placed his hands on him and healed him. When this had happened, the rest of the sick on the island came and were cured. They honored us in many ways, and when they were ready to sail, they furnished us with the supplies we needed. I continue this morning that unless you see the big picture, unless you refuse to get up when times are tough and coming against you, you cannot see the greatness of God and what He has in store for you. Do we believe that God has a plan? We don't always trust the plan. It's sometimes impossible to trust the plan. But after Paul was shipwrecked, after he was almost killed while he was in the sea, and after Paul was bitten by a snake, everyone on the island was healed. Paul kept going. Paul did not allow his pessimism to rise up within him. Instead, Paul trusted in the Lord. And so when you're going through what you think is a bad day, how do you handle these situations? Before we take a closer look, let's ask the Lord to bless our time. Faith, would you open us in prayer this morning?
Well, Lord, it's so good to be in your house, Lord and Father. We can look to you for your promises and your purpose, Lord. And Father, I thank you for this time that we can reflect upon your birth, Lord God, the Savior of the world, Lord. And we just thank you, and Father, we just ask you to open up your word to us, Lord God, and Father, we just thank you that we will receive what you have for us this day. In Jesus' name, amen.
So this morning, there are three reasons that Paul would have had to be pessimistic while going through this time. But he didn't allow these things to take away from what the Lord had told him was going to happen. And the first reason to be pessimistic would be a shipwreck. How many of you would a shipwreck ruin your day? Amen. But if you think about how scared that they were being at sea during this storm while aboard a ship, imagine doing it and how scary it would be surviving the storm without a ship. For just, you know, people have been building ships as a way to travel across the ocean for so long, and it's a much more efficient manner to go across the open water than swimming. And so if you were aboard a ship and you ran aground and the storm would break the ship into pieces, you could claim to be having a bad day. And that's where we find Paul. Here's what the scripture says happened. It says, after he said this, he took some bread and gave thanks to God in front of them all. Paul knew exactly what was coming. And yet he gave thanks to God because he believed God and trusted in God for the outcome. He broke it and began to eat. They were all encouraged and ate some food themselves. And altogether there were 276 of us on board. When they had eaten as much as they wanted, they lightened the ship by throwing the grain into the sea. And when daylight came, they did not recognize the land, but they saw a bay with a sandy beach where they decided to run the ship aground if they could. Cutting loose the anchors, they let them into the sea and at the same time untied the ropes that held the rudders. Then they hoisted the foresail to the wind and made for the beach. But the ship struck a sandbar and ran aground. The bow stuck fast and would not move, and the stern was broken to pieces by the pounding of the surf. So how many of you are familiar with the story of the Titanic? Anybody? And you know that the Titanic was an unsinkable ship, and so they claimed. And they even carried on eating and drinking and playing music even well after they struck the iceberg for a long time, because they didn't believe that the ship was going to sink until the very last minutes. But that's not the case here. Paul told them exactly what was going to happen. He told everyone on board, he said, there's going to be a shipwreck. So if you're on board a ship and you're told there's going to be a shipwreck, what do you do? Get off? Who's going to scream and run around? It's going to be chaos on board. And even some of the people on board the ship were trying to let the lifeboat down so that they could hop out. And they were pretending to lower anchors, but they were really dropping the lifeboat. And they were getting out of there. So how would you look in this situation? Who would be panicked? Who would be calm? It'd be hard to be calm in a situation like that. But that is exactly where we find Paul. In our world, a shipwreck would always be bad news, reason to be a pessimist. But think about this for a second. The waters are powerful enough that they break the ship to pieces while it's sitting there on the sandbar. And yet, how many casualties did they incur? Zero. 276 people on board this ship with zero fatalities. Now, the Titanic was supposed to be the height of modern civilization. It was the ship of all ships, and when it went down, it lost 1,500 of the 2,224 people on board. And it wasn't even in a storm. So it was God's promise coming true in the water that had Paul reaching down to find hope. God was a gracious God. And Paul knew that God was a God who kept his promise. That was a reason for optimism. So reason number one to be pessimistic, the shipwreck. Reason number two, the guards wanted to kill him. Now, I spent nearly a decade of my life as a lifeguard, and I taught other people how to be lifeguards, and I've pulled over 50 people out of the water who were drowning, and I've taught others how to do the same thing. And the first lesson that they teach you when you're becoming a lifeguard is this. When you're saving someone from drowning, make sure you don't drown yourself. I've got another old lifeguard back here. Because when someone is drowning or they feel like they're drowning, they panic. They're all over the place. And so they don't realize what they're doing, but when you swim out to them, the first thing they want to do is they want to put you under the water and hold themselves up, and they don't care what happens to you. It's just the reaction that occurs. I'm going to hold you under to keep me afloat. And that's why you see all the lifeguards nowadays have those big red tubes. Because you swim out to the person, you keep yourself a good distance away, and you throw them the red tube, and if they continue to fight, you leave them there until they calm down. That's how we teach that. Because it's such a danger. When people are in this situation and not knowing how to swim, and they're all in this ocean that is raging all around them, it would have been very easy for the guards to say, Yeah, so we don't die in this situation, and so no one drowns us. Let's just kill all of the prisoners and escape with our own lives. That would have been entirely, altogether, not unrealistic. Because there was panic, there would have been fear, and there would have been people trying to use other people to keep them afloat. When you're in the ocean swimming in a storm, it's a bad day. But God had different plans. He took this situation where there's normally chaos, and he brings peace into the middle of it. Here's what it says from our scripture. It says, the soldiers planned to kill the prisoners to prevent any of them from swimming away and escaping. But the centurion wanted to spare Paul's life and kept them from carrying out their plans. He ordered those who could swim to jump overboard first and get to land, and the rest of them to get there on planks or on other pieces of the ship. And this way, everyone reached land safely. Once safely on shore, we found that the island was called Malta, and the islanders showed us unusual kindness. They built us a fire and welcomed us all because it was raining and cold. So, a pessimist wants to look at the shipwreck. And the fact that there are people everywhere not that don't know how to swim in the water, but the optimist looks at the whole picture. God provided a plan of escape for each person that was on the ship. Some of them, he allowed the ability to swim. Others who didn't have the ability to swim, God sent planks and pieces of wood and pieces of the ship their way so that they could be protected from the elements. And to top it all off, when they washed up off of the ship, he provided people of unusual kindness to take them in and to put them around a warm fire. Tell me that God doesn't care for every one of his children. We only know of Paul who worshiped this God, and yet because of Paul's faith, he spared this whole shipload of people. That is a reason for optimism. So, reason number two for pessimism, the guards wanted to kill Paul. Reason number three, and it almost pains me to say it, the snake bite. Oh! Here's what it says from our scripture. Talk about a bad day getting worse. Paul gathered a pile of brushwood, and as he put it on the fire, a viper driven out by the heat fastened itself on his hand. And when the islanders saw the snake hanging from his hand, they said to each other, this man must be a murderer, for though he escaped from the sea, the goddess Justice has not allowed him to live. But Paul shook the snake off in the fire and suffered no ill effects. The people expected him to swell up or suddenly fall dead. But after waiting a long time and seeing nothing unusual happen to him, they changed their minds and said that he was a god. Now, the word used here is viper is typically translated as a poisonous snake. And I've heard people say, even from the pulpit, that Paul got lucky because he got bit by a non-venomous snake. But this word says otherwise. And the reaction of the eyewitnesses, the islanders, shows us that they expected Paul to die from this bite. They recognized the snake. They knew it to be poisonous. And so they were expecting that Paul would surely die. I was present when a friend of mine got bit by a rattlesnake. Has anyone ever seen that? It's disgusting. We were on a nature hike, and he saw a snake down there and went to pick it up. It had lost its rattle, and he had misidentified it. And so when he went to pick it up, it got him on the hand. After 15 minutes, this is what happened. There's no mistaking what a venomous snake bite does to a person. This is what a venomous snake bite does to a person. And so we rushed him to Hershey Medical Center. They took care of him, and after several weeks and months, they were able to clear him, and he's doing fine to this day. But this is exactly what the islanders thought would happen to Paul. Because this is what happens when you're bitten by a poisonous snake. As a pessimist, it would be easy to chalk up a snake bite as a bad day, as something bad happening to you. But even God can turn a snake bite into something to get excited about. How many of you get excited thinking about a snake fight? Not a single one of us. This is also what happens. They saw nothing happening to Paul. There was an estate nearby that belonged to Publius, the chief official of the island. He welcomed us to his home and showed us generous hospitality for 3 days. His father was sick in bed, suffering from fever and dysentery. Paul went in to see him and after prayer placed his hands on him and healed them. When this had happened, the rest of the sick on the island came and were cured. They honored us in many ways, and when they were ready to set sail, they furnished us with the supplies that we needed. So because Paul didn't allow the events of his day to deter him from his faith in God, from his trust in God, there was a mini revival that happened with a healing tent, that where everyone on the island could come and be healed of their diseases. That's the good news of the story. Because Paul believed God, and in Romans 8:28, Paul writes this promise. He says, "We know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose." He had seen over and over and over again, despite his circumstances, despite all of the bad things that he was going through, he saw God working every situation to good. Do we have an all-good and all-knowing God? If we believe that we do, there is reason for optimism, despite what we're going through. We can have joy in all the trials that we go through because we know that God is up to something. The devil, he's the one that tries us to get us to focus on the bad that's happening and be pessimistic. But God says, because you belong to me, there is reason and always reason for optimism. I tell you, Paul takes the cake for having a bad day. He was shipwrecked. He floated along the ocean. Can you imagine as he's floating there on a piece of wood and one soldier says to the other soldier, "Let's just kill all the prisoners." And then when he got on shore, he was bitten by a poisonous snake. But Paul kept focused on who he was serving instead of what was going on around him. And he got to experience the blessing of seeing every sick person on that island healed. Could you imagine how much joy there would have came out of that? How much blessing would have came out of that? Because Paul kept his eyes focused on the Lord. Don't think of the world as a rose bush with thorns. Believe instead in the God that says, okay, this world may have thorn bushes, but I'm going to give even the thorn bushes roses. There is a reason to be optimistic because God is doing something wonderful even when we can't see it. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, we can barely see in front of us sometimes. And when the bad days rage and when they storm against us, Father God, we're so tempted, and so many times we look at the bad things that are happening to us, and instead of looking to a God who's got all things under his control. Lord, even at Christmas time, when we look at the whole picture, there is reason for joy. But we know it would have been easy for Mary and Joseph in that time just to give up, just to give in to the bad things around them. But Lord, they kept focused on you. Lord, even your son had to come and experience death for us to realize that we can have eternal life. Lord, you have a plan. You have a purpose. Help us to see the good in what you are doing. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Would you stand with us as we sing? This is one of my favorite Christmas songs. You don't have many. This is one of my favorite because it reminds me of why we celebrated in the first place. It was a little baby child who came to rest in a little manger, and not much was expected of him, but he came to be Christ the King. Let's sing together. What child is it? Joy of optimism this Christmas week. You are dismissed. Have a great week.